Morning, everybody. That's pretty good for a Friday morning, last day of the conference, but I think you can do better. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
That's much better. Welcome to Inside Windows Azure, the cloud operating system. My name is Mark Krasinovich, and let me just start here by telling you how I've got my way into Azure. Some of you probably heard this story yesterday if you came to my Mysteries of Memory Management talks, but I joined Microsoft in the middle of 2006. My whole career has been spent on Windows internals, and so I joined the Windows division, worked on the tail end of Vista, worked on Win7, and then when Win7 was done and we were working on the next version of Windows, I started to look around and was talking to some other people in the company, including Dave Cutler, the original architect of Windows NT. He'd started this new project right as I joined Microsoft that eventually became what is Windows Azure today. In the process of talking to him and some of the other people that I respect at the company and looking at what was happening with these shifts in technology, it became really clear to me that the future of Microsoft really is going to be based on what I'm going to be talking about this morning, that we're undergoing two massive shifts in technology that are related to each other, so they're happening at the same time. One of them is the shift to mobile computing, where the phone's becoming a PC, the tablet's becoming an integral part of people's lives. We're having more and more of these connected devices. But at the hub of all those devices is this cloud platform connecting everything. This is what the mobile devices store their data in. This is how they talk to each other through the cloud. And so those two together really are changing what's going on with computing. And I decided that what was going on with Windows Azure, I'd have an opportunity to really develop or help develop something that I hope becomes the new Windows 3.1 of the cloud, the Windows 3.1 of the cloud operating system here. And so that's why I joined the Windows Azure group back last summer in the middle of July. And I'm on a team called the Fabric Controller. I'll talk today about what the Fabric Controller is. But my goal for this morning is to, first of all, just level set about what the cloud is and what Windows Azure is, what Windows Azure's philosophy is about what it's trying to deliver and do. Then I'll get into the fundamentals of Azure. What is an Azure application? How is it composed? How do you write one? I'll write a really quick one, and we'll play with it in the development fabric. Then I'll get into what goes on underneath the hood. What is running the data centers, and what is hosting these applications? That's the Fabric Controller component. I'll talk about what its responsibilities are. And then I'll go through various operations that you would perform when you're managing your Windows Azure service, including what happens when you deploy a service. We'll talk about what happens when you go through updating your service to change the configuration or change the bits. And then what happens when we're going through and patching the data center, the host operating system that these services are running on. What happens to your services as that happens? And then how Windows Azure is monitoring the health of your applications and the blades in the data center and what it does when it detects that something's wrong, how it operates in those conditions. So what is a cloud? This is what I define as a cloud, and I think the whole industry is congealing on a definition that's very like this, although you will go and if you look up cloud in Wikipedia, you will see other definitions or variants of this. But I view it as an on-demand, scalable, multi-tenant, self-service compute resource, where, and a couple of things that to highlight there. On-demand means that you get the compute when you need it. Self-service means that you don't have to go and ask somebody to give it to you. You just go and request it and acquire it. This is different from the on-premise data center model, where if you're an application developer, you have to go to the IT pros and say, I want to deploy an application. They ask you about the sizing requirements for it. They provision the physical servers, the host the virtual machines that you're going to run, they deploy the virtual machine, then ask you for the bits and deploy those bits into it. And it's a process that takes quite a long time, whereas this is hopefully as instantaneous as you just saying, yes, I want it, and give it to me now. Self-service and multi-tenant and scalable. So scalable means that if your compute resource requirements grow, you can just simply request more. And multi-tenant is really what makes the cloud so have such a return on investment, makes it so valuable in terms of you getting cheap compute versus the expensive compute that you might have if you're managing your own data centers and your own servers. Multi-tenancy allows the cloud platform to have lots and lots of machines that are, and it's essentially an over-provisioned set of resources where we don't expect everybody to use it all at once or demand it all at once, and so that means we can over-provision, and when somebody gets those resources, it appears that they get access to the whole data center, when that might not be the case, but that lets the cost be shared really among everybody and lets the scale drive costs down as well. It's a lot cheaper to buy servers in the numbers of tens of thousands than buy them individually, and so you get that kind of scale savings as well. This is something I saw recently, which shows that the cloud is really entering almost the mainstream as the buzzword du jour. So that's the rest of the talk, blah, 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 blah. Which I'll be talking about. Okay, let's talk about some different types of clouds. And there's three basic types of clouds, and this is going to be a review for some of you especially. How many people saw Dave Chappell's talk earlier in the week about Windows Azure? So just a few of you. Well, so for those people, this might be a little bit of review, and for others, this might also be a review, but let's just get crisp about what these terms mean, at least from my perspective and Microsoft's perspective. There's infrastructure as a service, IaaS, which is the ability to essentially rent a server in somebody else's data center and put on it the operating system you want, put on it the application you want, the runtimes you want. And because you're looks like you're renting a server, you're responsible for everything from that server all the way up the stack. Examples of this, EC2, for example. You take whatever you want, the image is yours, you're in charge of patching it, you're in charge of monitoring the health of it. Then there's platform as a service, or PaaS. This is basically an application platform that you take your application and run it on the shared compute resources and possibly storage resources. On-demand application hosting, the difference between this and the first one is that your application has to be coded to the PaaS application platform that you're going to be deploying on. So if you're going to deploy it on Google App Engine, you need to write to the Google App Engine APIs and deploy your application that way. If you're going to write it to Windows Azure, you're going to have to fit into the Windows Azure application model. And then software as a service, this is, of course, you just consuming apps that are up in the cloud, like Gmail or Office 365. By the way, there's a fourth one that I've heard of, and this is from the IT pros that don't believe in the cloud. It's called MIAS, and I'm not sure what that stands for. So if you know. And actually, there's another kind of funny one it's called security as a service. Suck as. So here's the table of just showing what you're responsible for versus what the cloud provider is responsible for as you move from IaaS all the way to SaaS. And you can see if you're starting with standalone servers, you're responsible for everything. When you get to SaaS, they're handling absolutely everything. They're provisioning the application, everything the application runs on. What you lose going to the right is control. Some people like control. There's certain applications where you need control and certain environments where you need control. So it means that over on the right side isn't going to be appropriate for everybody. What the cloud aims to do is hit the general case as much as possible, hit that 90% case, and get people to take the efficiency that comes with that, because as you move right, you get more efficient. When you're moving all the way to software as a service, you're not buying blades, you're not hiring IT pros to manage those blades. And I know that there's IT pros in here that are afraid that they're going to lose their jobs because of the cloud. How many people are afraid that you're going to lose your job because of the cloud? Let's see, raise your hands. Okay, there's not many of you, so fine, I don't want to talk about that anymore. Everybody's happy with the cloud. So, no, seriously, just a second here about IT pros in the cloud. Certain types of IT pro roles will start to disappear. It will take a long time to disappear. We'll have on-premise data centers and servers for a long time. But what you're going to see, I think, is starting with small businesses starting by, hey, I don't need a server. I'm just going to use all software as a service and have my client applications all talk to software as a service. And that will move up the stack. And eventually, you'll have medium businesses that don't want data centers and then eventually large businesses. It's going to take 10 to 20 years for that to happen. In the meantime, IT pros have important roles managing the existing resources that you've got, as well as helping the migration to the cloud. You're going to see hybrid environments for a long time, and that's going to be the first step when companies that have existing data center resources, server resources, moving some applications to the cloud and wanting to make sure that those applications connect back onto on-premise. So you're going to be configuring network connections between the two. You've still got security policies to manage. You've still got to worry about performance, operating those applications that you're going to be responsible for. So there's tons of stuff to do, and there's more stuff to learn. So it's not like your job is going to go away. It's just going to transform over the next 10 to 20 years. So that's my, you shouldn't feel bad about the cloud. You should embrace it and run with it. Windows Azure is a form of platform as a service. And the way we view its operation is it's really an operating system for the data center where it treats the whole data center as one machine, where it's monitoring the health of the different parts of the machine. It's deploying resources from that machine. It's responsible for provisioning the pieces, monitoring what's going on, and defining what exactly an Azure application is, and then providing the building blocks to let that application run. The idea behind platform as a service is that somebody running to write a cloud application, writing a web service, a cloud service, can avoid having to worry about what the operating system does or how to create failover clustering and write highly available, highly scalable applications, that the platform helps make that extremely easy. That's the idea behind cloud platform as a service. The idea that a developer can say, or an IT pro managing the service can say, capacity's demand load is increasing, spin up another instance, increase capacity. And that just happens seamlessly, transparently, which is something that's much harder to do if you're talking about traditional server applications where those are a different model that I'll talk about in a second. So Windows Azure provides you a shared pool of compute, disk, and network resources. It's virtualized. So just like we've got virtualization on the desktop within a machine, we've got virtual memory, we've got virtualization on a server where you've got virtual machines running on the server, we've got here a virtual set of data center resources, including storage, networking, and compute, where the virtualization allows us to over-provision and to isolate the different applications that are running from each other. And then Windows Azure also has a set of building blocks for building distributed applications. Some of those you might have already heard of in the form of AppFabric, Windows Azure Storage, SQL Azure, AppFabric Access Control Server, and Service Bus. Those are all PaaS middleware building blocks. The Windows Azure philosophy is designed for failure. This is kind of a different philosophy than a lot of people take when they're writing applications. And when I say writing applications, really platform is, what I'm talking about is platform as a service. This is about developing applications to run in a cloud environment as a highly available, highly scalable cloud application. As from an IT pro perspective, you're probably not going to be, or most of you probably not going to be writing applications, but you're going to be managing applications that are written to this. And where platform as a service really fits in is it's the platform to build software as a service. So line of business app is an example of software as a service in the data center. So the philosophies here around design for failure, scale out for capacity, scale out for redundancy, have short timeouts. Assume that when you're communicating that there's going to be a failure. So have a short timeout and then have retry logic behind it. Make sure that the operations you perform, that they're idempotent, which means that you can perform them more than once. That's another Azure philosophy. You can perform them more than once and get the same result. That is required for this design for failure mentality, where if you've got two services, two pieces of your service, both trying to perform an operation, that operation fails on one of them, the other one picks it up and then performs it and it succeeds, but the first one then retries and it succeeds, that you haven't screwed things up. And then finally, stateless. Stateless with external durable store. The philosophy behind Windows Azure applications is that the applications, the code, is really throwaway. It's just there to process data, to compute. And that if you want to store state, you do it someplace where it's durable. And that means externally in durable store, which includes SQL Azure and Windows Azure Storage. And these are the characteristics that you get when you code your application to the Windows Azure application model. And to understand why these were actually very intentionally designed into the Windows Azure platform, go back to David Cutler, who was one of the key people that started the Windows Azure project. He'd, of course, architected VMS and Windows NT, and he'd seen what happened with the Windows application model. And the Windows application model, I'll just be polite and say it's not the most robust application model. I mean, there isn't even a definition for what a Windows application is. When you think of a Windows application, you think I'm installing something, but do you know where it installed to? Do you know where its settings are? Do you know how to take it and lift it off and put it on another machine? Do you know how to take and put on new configuration? Applications do whatever the heck they want to in Windows. There's no definition. And that means that managing Windows applications is extremely difficult. We've got hacks like ServerAppV, which ServerAppV tries to identify where that application state is and separate it. And you get some benefits when it comes to separating state of an application. You can got buckets of state. You've got the application settings, you've got the application code, you've got the operating system settings, and you've got operating system code. If you separate all those, it makes it easy to change config and know that you've updated the config reliably. It makes it easy to take that config and move it someplace else. It makes it easy to know that you're updating the binaries and be able to look at the system and see that you've got the updated binaries there. And then service the operating system separately from the application. So that's the way that Windows Azure was designed. The application is separated from the operating system, in this case, Windows Azure. And the characteristics you get when you design your application to this is that you get automated, consistent application updates. When you update a Windows Azure cloud application, you take the config or the code and you tell Windows Azure to update the app while it's running. Windows Azure goes and updates the code or configuration, and instead of taking the config that you're giving it and merging it with what's there, instead of you having to connect into each instance of your service and modify the config manually, what Windows Azure does is take the config you're giving it, march through your service, and replace whatever config is there with the new config. Just completely replace it. So you know when the config update is done that the config you just gave it is the config that's there. If the config works in your test environment, that config should work in your production environment. Multi-instance management, I talked about scale out and for availability and for capacity. And what you want to do when you're scaling out, especially if you're scaling out to thousands of machines, which is what Windows Azure is designed for, when you've got a load that's just humongous, or even if it's just a few hundred or a few dozen, you don't want to have to go manage each one of those individually. This is what you have to do typically in a data center environment. If you scale out an application, you get now 10 or a dozen virtual machines running that application. Each one's got a unique name. Each one's got unique network configuration. Each one's got unique application configuration. And you're responsible for managing each and every one of those, maintaining the health of them, troubleshooting them when there's something goes wrong. With Windows Azure, you treat all of those clones of each other just as if they were one group, one unit. Here's the config for that group. Stop that group, start that group, grow that group, shrink that group. Those are the kinds of operations you get. Scale out, like I said, because you've got this clone mentality, scaling out's as easy as spin me up another clone of this instance. High availability you get because you've scaled out your application, you've got all these clones. They're clones, they've got no local state because they persist their state in external durable store, which means they're completely throwaway. You can shoot one in the head and your service continues to run as long as you've got another one. So they're like drones, just blow them away and you're good. And then finally, because the application, your service, is separated from the Windows Azure platform, we can service the Windows Azure platform underneath your application without you having to worry about it. So no more Windows Server Update service, no more having to do Windows Update, no more having to make sure Windows is patched. We're doing that for you in a very reliable way. The settings are separated from your app so that there's no collisions there, minimizing the chance of something breaking when there might be conflicts between settings. And this chart here shows basically the three different main application design patterns. If we start on the left is single instance persistent operating system. In other words, Windows Server application. A Windows Server application, for a typical Windows Server application, unless it's been designed by Einstein developers to be highly scale out and available with clustering, the typical server application is just some guy sits and writes an app, that app stores state in the registry, stores some state on disk and files, might have a SQL server. That SQL server might be actually installed in the same server. It expects it to be right there. So the whole thing is just glued together in one glob, tightly connected with the OS. And if you lost that server, you just lost data. And you've also have a big emergency on your hands. Somebody's got, the alarm bells are ringing, somebody's got to go figure out how to get that application up and running again. When you move to a single instance stateless operating system, this is what service-oriented architectures often have, especially with the front ends, which are supposed to be scalable. You want to scale out your front ends to take in requests from the outside, and those are essentially clones of each other. Yes, in today's world, they're individual machines that you've got to have managed. You've got to give them names, you've got to configure them, but it's not a big deal if you lose one because they're not storing anything locally. They're just supposedly clones of each other. So you get some of the benefits of Windows Azure kind of application model when you go to that scale-out architecture. But when you go to the Windows Azure one, all the way on the right, you get all those benefits, which is the multi-instance stateless operating system model. Before I dig in a little bit more and talk about the Windows Azure application model and actually show you, just that here's when we say Windows Azure platform includes all of this. And what I'm focusing on in this talk this morning is compute. But we've also got Windows Azure storage, which includes blobs, one of the most technical terms I've ever come across, blob. Anybody know what blob stands for? Binary large object, blob. I like saying that, blob. Tables, queues, Windows Azure CDN, content distribution network. This allows you to cache stuff on our data centers that are spread around the world, so that's close to your static content that's close to your customers. SQL Azure, and then the middleware services that I mentioned. So let's get into Windows Azure fundamentals now. A typical cloud application consists of usually a front end, a middle tier that does business logic, and then the storage, where the state is stored. This is familiar to anybody that does service-oriented architecture. Canonical three-tier application, front end, load balanced, scale out, middle tier, again, scale out to handle load, and then persistent durable store. And this scale out, by the way, that's a different aspect, different from the Windows Server design mentality, the scale out. When we discuss internally in Windows Azure, the server application model, it's scale up. When you want to have more capacity handled by your server application, what do? You give it more RAM, give it faster CPUs. That's scaling up. Whereas Windows Azure, if you want more capacity for your, throw more capacity, more load at your application, you scale it out instead of up. Your building blocks are small, but you can create many of them to get that, handle that load, and that's this model right here. Now the Windows Azure service model, we call Windows Azure applications called a service, and its service consists of a definition, what exactly the construction of that application is, the configuration, and at least one role that makes up that service. The definition is the architecture of the application, and it is what is going to be consistent regardless of where you deploy that application. We think of the definition as what the developer defines. When the developer codes the application, they know how it's constructed, and they specify that declaratively in the service definition. The config is what, at runtime, the application reads and uses to know how to operate, like connection strings, for example. And we view the configuration as what the IT pro defines for the application. Developer hands the IT pro the app, says deploy the app. IT pro knows, hey, I need to config the networking this way to connect back to on-premise. I need to config the SQL Azure connection string this way to connect to our production database. And they deploy it that way. And then the roles are like DLLs. Of course, coming from a Windows background, I have all these analogies in my head as I try to map what I know from Windows programs to Windows Azure. So in Windows, you've got an application, which is the closest thing we got in Windows to an application is a process. That's the most clear definition of what a program is you say, oh, that process is running. That's my program. And programs or processes in Windows are made up of DLLs. Those are the building blocks that make up the process, decomposed into little functional units that all combine together, provide you the functionality of the program. With a Windows Azure service, those building blocks are called roles. They're like DLLs. You compose them together, and now you've got your Windows Azure service. And each service has to have at least one role, of course, and it has to have at least two instances of each role. Now, today, an instance of a role maps to a virtual machine. And that might change in the future. We might have sub-virtual machine roles. But today, it's a single virtual machine, and the Windows Azure SLA requires that you have at least two of those in each of your roles in your application. And the SLA we give, whoops, that wasn't good. Let's see if my laptop survives that. So the Windows Azure SLA requires, gives you a 99.95% uptime. How much uptime do you think Amazon EC2 gives you? What's their SLA for their compute? Anybody know? 99.95? Yep, 99.95, actually. And is that a single instance SLA or a multi-instance SLA that Amazon has? Anybody know that? It was tested recently. Amazon had a cloud burst a few weeks ago, so I call it. So the Amazon SLA, this is, I think, one of the places where when I go talk to people, there's a misconception. And the misconception is, wait a minute, my EC2 instance, Amazon's got a 99.95% SLA on it, whereas when I go read Microsoft's SLA for Azure, it says I need two instances. That's not right. I need to pay for two to get the SLA. When Amazon, I only need one. Well, if you go read the fine print on Amazon's SLA, you need two instances in two different availability zones, they call them. Availability zones can be in the same data center. They're just separated physically in some way that they don't define very well. But that's what you need to get the Amazon 99.95% SLA. So actually, the SLA requirements are the same for us and Amazon. We actually make it easier for you to get that SLA because in the Amazon EC2 world, you have to create two virtual machines, and you're basically in the Windows Server application model, two machines now to manage, to update, to patch, to monitor. Whereas here, with this role model, those two instances are no more of a management burden for you than one. And the way that we achieve our SLA is with two concepts that are built into the Windows Azure platform. Those two concepts are update and fault domains, and that's By implementing these concepts, which are unique to Windows Azure, this is how we can help your application achieve that 99.5% SLA in the face of your planned outages, because it's either we're doing updates to the data center and we're going to be patching the host operating system underneath your role, or you're going to be updating your own application. So your updates might require the role instances to restart to get new config, for example, or restart to use new binaries. And then the faults domains are for the unplanned outages that we help you tolerate as well. So before I get into the, well, I might as well do this, and then we'll show you the application. I'll build a little application. But the first concept, the update domains, like I said, is for planned updates, for you to be able to have uptime during planned updates. And we've got this concept of update domains that you program into your service. If you don't specify, you get 5 update domains in your service. You can actually specify a lower number than that. Today, you can't specify a higher number than 5, although that might be changed in the future. And when you have a number of update domains, whenever you update the config or the binaries of your service, we take slices across your tiers and assign them to different update domains and then update them one at a time. So this new code here up here, we've got new code for the front end, new code for the middle tier, and we've got a deployed service with 2 instances of the front end, 3 instances of the middle tier. Because we've got the default of 5 update domains, those were spread across 3 update domains. The middle tier has 3 instances, so they're across the full 3. And now when we do our update, what Windows Azure does is coordinates this with your running instances, tells that first update domain, hey, time to shut down. So those guys shut down. The new ones get deployed and get started up. And when they're ready and up and running, then Windows Azure moves to the next update domain. Then when those are up and running, we move to the third one. So at no time was the service ever completely down. One way to look at the number of update domains you've got is that 1 over the number of update domains is the percentage of your service that's going to be down at any one point in time during a planned update, whether it's ours or yours. So 10 instances, 20% of your service is going to be down at any given point in time. So you're going to have reduced capacity during the update, but you're always available. One thing to note, though, is that you're going to have mixed, in this in-place update that I'm showing you, is that you've got a mix of the old and new running side by side with each other, which is something to be aware of when you're developing your application. But now you can see that part of the SLA that we help you get when you update your service is based on this update domain concept. When you update your service, you say go update, and we march through these automatically and update your service one update domain at a time. And this is the canonical way to update cloud applications. All major software as a service applications do this kind of update, this in-place update, where parts of the service get updated. In fact, in most cloud applications, big production ones, they update one slice, and they see if that's okay. So if that slice, if they've broken something, it's only impacting a small number of customers, and they can roll it back. So Windows Azure also gives you the ability to do a manual walk of your update domains if you want to do it one slice at a time. And the second concept is that of fault domains. This is the unplanned outage protection. Now, unplanned outages are much more rare than the planned outages, although they still occur. How many people manage data centers or servers today of you? How many of you have experienced a server failure in the last week of some kind? Disk failure, memory, so a few of you. How about the last month? So you know that you start to have lots of servers, you're going to have failures. We've got tens of thousands of servers in our data centers. There's failures every single day. Every hour, there's servers failing. It's just the fact of hardware. Disks fail. We've got memory. Disk failure is number one. Memory failure is number two. And then there's random other failures that we experience as well. And so what we want to make sure is that when there's a failure, that your service doesn't go completely out, that the lights aren't shut off on it. We can't avoid having your service get reduced capacity, but we don't want it to go completely down. So we define this concept of fault domains. Wherever there's a single point of failure in the data center, we consider that a fault domain. There's lots of redundancy built into our data centers. I'll show you a little behind the scenes of our data center architecture in a little bit, but there's lots of redundancy, but there still are single points of failure. And we will put your service instances, role instances, across at least 2 single points of failure. So there's 2 fault domains defined for a service. Today, you can't override that. In the future, you will be able to and define a greater number of fault domains. And at the end, I'll talk to you about some of the things that are coming with Windows Azure and why we want to do that. But now you can see that if one of those fault domains fails, your service is still running. So that middle fault domain might fail, but you're still up and running because the other instances on the other fault domains are continuing to operate. And we also then try to bring up your, replace those instances that failed with new instances, new incarnations of them, after that happens and we detect it happens, which I'll talk about later. So let's go build a service. And while we're building a service, we'll get an idea of what's inside of a service. So I'm going to fire up Visual Studio. Now this service is a very simple service. I've actually got the code here in template, you know, copy and paste form. There's 3 files. And I'm going to define this application, and then we're going to paste these files into the application. And we're going to, while we're doing this, what we're doing is building a multi-tier, highly available, highly scalable cloud application, and it will just take us a few minutes. And then we'll get into the debugger, and I'll show you the development fabric and how easy it is to debug these things. So let's say new project. And it's Windows Azure project, Cloud Service 1. I'm not even going to bother naming it. And we want 2 roles. And there's different role types you can see here. There's really, and I'll talk more about the role types in a second, but what we're going to do is create a web front end, MVC2, which is all the rage. Actually, MVC3 is now all the rage. I guess I'm behind the times. And then a worker role as well. So we've got 2 roles in our project, the front end and the middle tier. And this is asking us if we want to create a test project. I don't believe in testing. I'm so good. Right? I am, right? Sysinternals tool, it's pretty reliable. So here's our, actually, let's start with our front end. So our views, let's go to our views, and let's go to index. And this is the standard template, you know, welcome to MVC2 thing. We're going to go and replace it with this front end, this web page right here. And we'll see what that looks like in a second. Then we'll go into the controllers. This is the back end, the engine for that front end. Here's the home controller we're going to replace it with. It does the logic when we interact with that web page. And then let's go to the worker role. And here's our worker role. This is the template worker role. You can see Windows Azure calls a run function when your role starts up. And the default template code just sits here and says, yeah, I'm just sitting here hanging out. So let's replace that with my service worker role. And now I'm done. I need to add a few references here, and I'll explain why in a second. So one is document, open XML, and the other one is Windows base. And now I've got two things left to do. These roles expect to be talking to each other through Windows Azure Storage. So I need to, and they get their Windows Azure Storage connection strings through something called a data connection string. Data connection. And I'm going to point it at Windows Azure Storage Emulator because we're going to run it in the development fabric. And then let's go to the worker role and do the same thing. These are going to be config settings that are going to be dropped in the configuration file for the service. These are separated from the definition of the service, and actually case doesn't matter, but bugs me when I'm not the right case. And there I'm done, and now let's build. And now let's say go. Actually, before we say go, let me explain the architecture. The architecture of this is like this. Whoops. So, by the way, this is Zoomit I'm using here. So we've got a front end here. But I'm drawing on it. See? Okay, so where was I? So I've got a front end right there, and you saw, this is the web role, and then I got a back end over here, which is the worker role. I could use the shapes, but I'd like to see if I can draw circles. And then we've got Windows Azure Queue that we're going to use in the middle here. So that's a queue. Stuff goes in the front, comes out the back. And then we've got Blob Store, which I'll just represent with, a circle for a blob. Now, this app is called the Branding Police app. This is an app that it's really important at Microsoft. Actually, the marketing people haven't adopted it yet, but I'm going to try to sell it to them, I think. The problem with the marketing people is that they get really annoyed when you use certain words in your decks that aren't, you know, the proper Microsoft way of presenting the term. One of the words that they get really annoyed at is if you just say Azure. And actually, by the way, some people ask, what is the correct pronunciation? Is it Azure? Is it Azure? Is it Azure? And there is a correct pronunciation. I think you can go to the Windows Azure website and say, what's the correct pronunciation? There's a little audio clip. It's Azure. So let's all say that together. Azure. Like, as you're going to the store, think about the cloud. So the Branding Police app's job is for you to upload a PowerPoint to it, and it's going to look for branding violations. The word, in this case, my little demo here, looks for the word Azure without Windows in front of it. And so we upload our PowerPoint. That PowerPoint is dropped into Blob Store. And then the web front end sticks a message in a queue. Queues are Windows Azure Storage concept that allows for asynchronous communication between the tiers of the service. And their asynchronous communication is really important when you're working with or trying to design a reliable, highly available cloud application, because you don't want these things to be tightly coupled. You don't want it so that these things have a connection, and if that connection breaks, they've got to go reestablish it and figure out what's going on. Queues make it really easy to get reliable communication between the tiers of your app. The worker roles here are just listening on that, look at that queue. They're waiting for work to come in, and then they pull it off, and they look at it, and they say that work item is pointing at that blob and saying, go process that blob. So it'll go and read the blob out of store, process it, and then what it's doing in this case, just to be lazy, it's sticking a report back here in the blob, in table store, actually, that the website then presents. So it's writing any violations here, and then the website presents it up to the user. So that's the architecture of this application. Now let's run this application, and I'm going to set a breakpoint in a few places. So you can see one of the problems developing a multi-tier application is debugging it. Debugging a distributed application is a real pain. One of the, I think, really key features of the Windows Azure platform is this development fabric. We've created this multi-tier application, and I'm going to debug it connection between the front end and the back end here really easily. So let's go to the controller, and I'll show you what's going on in this as well. So this is when I get a file name handed up to me. It's going to hit this breakpoint. And then the back end, let's see, you can see right here, it's going to be looking at this queue here. It's creating a cloud queue client, looking at a queue named incoming, and it sits there in a loop waiting for 30 seconds at a time. So it's up to 30 seconds before it goes and pulls an item off the queue, and when it sees an item in the queue, and actually this is just for testing, you'd lower that to some number like 1 or whatever in your production environment, it's going to tell us which instance is processing it, and then it's going to call generate report and upload the results of that report to this same text table right here, or same blob. And this generate report, all that does is just call this XML thing and starts to look for regular expressions, Windows, or SQL without the, or Azure without the words Windows or SQL in front of it, and then we'll add the text around that to the report. And that's as simple as it is. So let's set a breakpoint for right here, which is when it picks up a message from the queue. And now let's say go. And this is going to fire up the Windows Azure development environment. And which will start up an instance of SQL Server Express on this that will mimic Windows Azure storage. So we're running completely in the development fabric. I could actually point it at production storage too if I wanted to test the data connection strings, as it would be in production. And now IE is going to start up, and we're going to get our front page. And now it's asking to say upload a PowerPoint presentation. So I'm going to say browse, and I'm going to give it one that I know. It's kind of big, but I know it's got violations in it. I'm going to say analyze. And then what's going to happen after the upload, boom, we hit the breakpoint. So let's zoom in here, and it's going to create the blob if it doesn't exist, the target blob, get the blob reference. It's going to put in the report this text, working on whatever, please refresh. Then it's going to create the queue if it doesn't exist right here, and then add a message that has that blob name, which is some GUID, to the queue. And then it's going to redirect to point at that little blob right here that has that text in it, and IE is smart enough to know just to present it as text. So I say go, but what's going to happen? So if we go back and look, this is the text right here. Please refresh. But we hit that breakpoint now in the worker. Here's the worker, picked up a message from the queue. So it's going to get that report, and it's going to replace the contents of that report that the IE is currently showing with currently being processed, and it's going to give its role instance ID. Every instance has a role instance ID. Because I only have one instance here in the development fabric, actually, if we scrolled over, that would be instance 0. And then it's going to upload that, and then it's going to call that get text reference. I press refresh, process by role 0. Let me say go, and then press refresh, and there's our branding violations. So the cool thing about it is that I've just made a cloud application. You've seen the entire list of it, and in the process of doing that, I've just made a scalable, highly available application. if you were to do this, try to do this with Windows Server kind of constructs, and I said, make me a branding violation app and make it scalable so that I can just scale it out and make it so that it can tolerate hardware failures, that would be incredibly time-consuming. You'd have to have Einstein programmers working on that. I just did it in a few minutes, and it's really as easy as it looks to do this. Now, if there's a lot other stuff you'd have to do to make it really production quality, but essentially that's what I've done. And now the branding service, I've actually got this deployed to the cloud, and I'll show you that later, but that is an application that I can literally, if I wanted to, just scale out if load got higher, and I'd be able to spin up more instances just by saying, increase the instance count. And that's what goes into the role. When we created those roles, the role name, the role type, whether it was a worker role or a web role, the size of the VM it's going to run in, the network endpoints that are configured, so we had to model the network connections if we wanted them to talk to each other. In this case, the role instances didn't talk via TCP, so that we didn't have to model anything there. Now, the code was a DLL, that DLL that we saw, that worker role, .cs, became a DLL. In the case of a VM role, you actually give it a VHD instead of a DLL. And that DLL, by the way, can come with all those other stuff. That's just the run required component. The entry point DLL, you can put exes and other DLLs and whatever their junk you want around it. And then the configuration, the number of instances and the number of update domains and fault domains. So there's three role types. We just saw two of them in action. The web role, which is, a web role is a Windows server. We create a poof up a Windows server instance for you with IIS, full IIS7 installed in it. So you can do all your ASP.NET and multi-home sites and all whatever directories and virtual directories. And worker role, though, is just a vanilla server with .NET 4 and 3.5 and 2 installed in it. And so this is, idea here is you put whatever you want in there. Now, some of the, you know, some people say, well, Windows Azure isn't as open as other environments. Well, when it comes to runtimes, we do, you know, have this one requirement of you creating a role entry point that's .NET for that DLL for us to call your onstart. But beyond that, you can do whatever you want. You could actually have that spin up Java or whatever else that you wanted, other runtime, to actually do your logic. So, because it's just server, whatever runs in server runs on server, will just run inside these VMs. VM role came out last PDC, and people said, hey, VM role, cool, now I can take my VHDs and just throw them up into Windows Azure Cloud. It's just like EC2. Has anybody tried to do that? Anybody play with VM role? Anybody heard of VM role? So how many people have heard of VM role and thought it was like EC2, infrastructure as a service? How many people didn't know what it was? Okay, so VM role, its name implies something that it's not. Its name implies that you can just take a server, a VHD running a Windows Server application and put it up in the cloud. But I've already talked about how the Windows Azure application model is different than servers. It's stateless. Now, most server applications are stateful. They stick stuff in the registry and on the local disk. So the problem with VM role, when you try to treat it that way as stateful, when it's really stateless, is you go and modify the configuration of it, that instance dies and gets reincarnated, you've just lost that configuration. You gotta go remake it now, because it's stateless. It starts with whatever base you give it. So people, when they learn that, they say, what good is it then? It's a waste of time, waste of, just ridiculous that you guys even included, created this. But it actually does have some value. There's several cases where using a worker role isn't maybe the right choice. If you've got a setup process that takes a long time, you know, you basically have to give Windows Azure your setup process as part of your role package, and it will then deploy that. When a new incarnation starts up, it'll run that. But if it takes 5 to 10 minutes, you don't want, when you scale up, having to wait 5 to 10 minutes for these instances to start. So if you could bake the install into a VHD and just give us the VHD, then your application's pre-installed. Same thing with config. So if you've got config that's manual, you can have that baked into the VHD. The downside of a VM role is that now you're responsible for the OS. So we can't patch the OS for you and main service it. If you want to update the code of your VHD, you've got to give us new differencing VHDs every time you do that. Whereas when you go with worker role, you just give us the new DLLs and exes and other metadata for your app. We update the OS underneath you, so you don't have to worry about that. When I built that application, some files got spit out, service definition and service config file. So those are the two files that, one is the basically just maps to the way that I structured the app, and the other one has the config for all the roles. CSDEF with all your role code gets packaged into a file called a package file. There, you can see there the service configuration, or sorry, the service package file there. And so those are the two pieces that you upload to the portal, the CSCFG and then the package file, which has the CSDEF and your code inside of it. And when you deploy to this portal, and by the way, here's a look at the portal. How many people have never seen the Windows Azure portal before, out of curiosity? Okay, so here's the Windows Azure portal. It's a Silverlight app, and we've got my service. I've got an instance of the branding police demo here, and you can see that I've got a worker role here with two instances and a web role with two instances here, because I'm in production now, so I need those two instances to be highly available. And what I did to upload this is from Visual Studio, you can upload, you can say publish here, and what that will do is just go to the portal and upload those two files. And when you upload those two files to the portal service, which is a Windows Azure service, just like the services that you make, takes that package and then gives it to something called RDFE, the RDFE service, which is another Windows Azure service. Anybody know what RDFE stands for? Red Dog Front End, right. Anybody know where the word Red Dog came from? The code name for Azure. That's what the original Azure team named themselves, the Red Dog team, when they started it. Anybody know why they came up with the word Red Dog? Some of you might have heard this story. Yeah, so Dave Cutler was driving around San Francisco, and I guess with some of the other members of the team, and they were trying to think of what code name to give themselves, and they drove past a place on the highway, I guess near the airport where these places normally are, called the Pink Poodle, and said, that's a nice establishment. I think we should code name our project after that. So he called it Red Dog. Now, I've driven around, and I haven't been able to find it, so if anybody finds that, you know, as part of my research into the history of Azure, I'd like to go see what that place is about, all about. Anybody been to the Pink Poodle, out of curiosity? Oh, one person, sir. Is it worth going? No, okay. I'll have to check just to make sure, but. All right, so here, once the Red Dog front end service gets it, it deploys it to the Fabric controller. And the Fabric controller then deploys it to the Fabric controller in the target region, because you get to specify which region you want your service deployed to, like North Central US, South Central US, Singapore, Hong Kong, whatever. And at that point, the Fabric controller stores that package in its own repository and then deploys it into the data center there. Let's take a look at the Fabric controller, its internals now. The Fabric controller, I wanted to work on this team inside of Windows Azure, because it is the equivalent to the kernel for the cloud operating system. Dave Cutler works in a different group, the Red Dog operating system team, where he's working on the hypervisor primarily. But the real true kernel of this distributed operating system is the Fabric controller. It is what manages the data center hardware. It is also what defines what a Windows Azure service is. So the application model is defined here, and that's a large part of my responsibility on the Windows Azure team, is to work on the evolution of the Windows Azure application model, to add more features to make it possible to build different types of cloud applications really easily. So it also manages the lifecycle of service and manages the health of the service. And the inputs are two things, the data center topology. So when we spin up a Fabric controller, we give it a map of the data center hardware resources, the blades, the racks, the top of rack routers, the IP addresses that it's going to manage, and we then give it services to run. By the way, these fabrics, this is a pet peeve of mine, because when I talk to people and they say, oh, you're Windows Azure, what do you do? And I say, I work on the Fabric controller team. They say, oh, App Fabric. And I say, no, the cool fabric, the Fabric controller. So the problem is that the word fabric has become really hip these days. And I don't know if people like to weave things or what, but Fabric is used, Windows Fabric, App Fabric, Fabric controller. And the App Fabric term is used actually in a few different places. One is as this composite application model for Windows Server applications, where you WCF, Windows Workflow Foundation applications. And then the other places, it's a brand on top of these PaaS middleware services. App Fabric Caching, App Fabric Service Bus, App Fabric Access Control Server, The connection between App Fabric and Windows Azure Fabric Controller is that these middleware services are written as Windows Azure services that are running on top of the Windows Azure Fabric Controller. So the Fabric Controller is really, we are the master of everything underneath. Here's a look at the data center architecture. And I mentioned that there's redundancy built in. We've got data center routers, they're duplicated. We've got aggregator routers, access routers, so the network topology is a little bit simplified in this picture. We've got load balancers, they're all duplicated as well. And then we've got racks and racks of blades. We've got typically 40 blades in each rack. We've got some single points of failure there. Atop a rack router, there's only one of them. There's a power distribution unit, which allows the fabric controller to manipulate the power states and reboot blades. And there's a couple of other components there on the racks that are single points of failure. So guess what a fault domain is? It's a rack. So when we are talking about spreading your service across fault domains, we're spreading them across racks in the data center. If a rack fails, you're still good to go. Here's a picture of the sample data center I've got in my house. Actually, I'm not. Actually, this is one of the test clusters that we've got on campus at Microsoft. It actually is the older generation of data centers. Let me show you a quick look of the newer style data centers. This is a public video of the way we're designing data centers now. This is the Quincy, Washington data center. Windows Azure hasn't been deployed there yet. It's still getting ready for production. And what the idea here is that these are prefab data centers. And the prefab part of it means that it's easy to add capacity to the data center. It's easy to migrate stuff off of stuff that's going old, aging out, and replace it. And these packs, they're pre-assembled containers. There's power supply packs, that's what you're looking at there. And then there's the IT pack, which is the blades pack, and that cooling system on top of it. And then once they're built, they're ready to be deployed. They're moved in their final positions, they're bolted together there, and you can see there's no walls on the data center, and that is actually intentional. That allows the cooling and heating systems to take advantage of ambient air. So they're placed in ideally, you place them in certain geographic locations where the air temperatures over the year optimize for heating and cooling efficiency. The Fabric Controller's architecture, it is also kind of like a Windows Azure service itself. It is replicated. It's got at least 5 instances. So we talked about availability and scale out. We've got 5 instances spread across fault domains of the Fabric Controller, at least 5, sometimes more. And the reason we've got more than 2 or 3 is that we can tolerate multiple failures. What we can tolerate is we can be updating the Fabric Controller, which we do about once a month. We're rolling out a new version of the Fabric Controller with bug fixes and enhancements and new parts of features that are going to be coming in the future. And so we can be updating it, meaning one of the update domains is down, have a hardware failure on another rack, and have a second hardware failure. So 2 hardware failures and an update going on, and we'll survive that with at least 5 instances. So that's a goal, is to be highly available there. And when we provision a node, so this is the Fabric Controller turning on a node, we power it on, we pixie boot a maintenance OS, which happens to be an OS that you're probably familiar with, Windows PE. Windows PE then formats the disk and downloads the host operating system, which is a VHD. Everything in Azure is boot from VHD. Everything is contained in VHDs. The host operating system boots, sysprep specializes, and reboots, and then an agent starts up in the host, which connects to the Fabric Controller and is ready to start taking commands now from the Fabric Controller. And once a node gets up and running and it actually has instances running, it just looks like a standard virtual machine architecture here. We've got the host partition with a host agent in it talking, it's a trusted component, there's trust boundaries, the hypervisor boundary. We've got virtual machines, the guest instances that we're talking to from the host side, to find out what's going on in the VMs and to talk to your service, get status from your service, and then your service is running as role instances there. Let's talk about now deploying a service. So the deployment starts with the processing of the service model files, figuring out what your service needs to run. Then the Fabric controller figures out where it's going to place your service. So it's allocating those resources from its set of resources, and then it's going to prepare the nodes to accept it, your service. So it's going to talk to the host agent, deploy down the role instances that are going to be running on a particular blade. That's going to create the virtual machines, start the virtual machines and the roles, and then Fabric controller is also configuring the network topology. So this is another part of what the cloud does, is handles all the complex networking stuff. It's programming load balancers. It's mapping VIPs to DIPs. Internally, you've got what are called dynamic IP addresses. Every service has one virtual IP address, which is a public IP address seen from the outside world. That virtual IP address can map to one or more DIPs underneath inside of your service. And then the resource allocation actually has two kinds of constraints. One are the hard constraints, which are just like, hey, I want a large VM or an extra large VM. By the way, extra large VM, the biggest one you can have is 8 cores. It has 14 gig of memory. To give you an idea of, we're not supposed to talk about how big our blades are, but you might be able to figure it out based on what I just told you. But don't tell anybody if you do. So the hard constraints are the size of the virtual machine you want, and the secondary soft constraints have to do with placement preferences, optimizing for network locality and for the ability to update the data center very quickly. And I'll talk more about that in a little bit, how that works. We produce a goal state, and then the Fabric controller is all goal state driven. It's a state machine. It's like, okay, next step is this. Next step to get to the goal state is this. And so in this case, we've got how many front ends do we have? Three front ends, two middle tiers that we're going to deploy as my service. So the machines are large, so those are 4 cores. You can see we're deploying to blades that have 8 cores. The reds are busy cores. So you get dedicated cores for everything from small and above. If you're extra small, you're sharing potentially a core with another 3 VMs that the hypervisor is scheduling, doing multiplex scheduling on a virtual core, basically. Then we deploy the other the back ends, and you can see they went onto the exact same blades as the front ends, two of the front ends. There happened to be space there, and the placement algorithm that I'll describe made that happen. And then the load balancers program to send traffic to the front ends, the DIPs of the front ends. So the front end, the VIP is mycloudapp.net, some IP address that we give you. And then they map to the back end. By the way, a question about people have about the front end IP addresses is they say, I've programmed my connection from my on-premise to the VIP. I need to open ports in the firewall. What happens to that IP address? I'd like to reserve an IP address. What we're actually going to come out and document very soon, it's always been the case, is that when your service gets an IP address, your IP address, you get that IP address as long as your service is deployed. We never take it away from you, and we never change it. So that IP address is basically yours for as long as you want it. When we provision a role instance, a few things happens. We create 3 VHDs. Now, remember, everything's VHD-based. So we create a VHD that contains your role code, that DLL that you saw with other files that you've got. We create a VHD for the host operating system. And those are deployed to the role, to the host. But then we create differencing VHDs on top of those things, so that when your role instance modifies the OS, those modifications go into differencing VHD. If we want to reset the OS, we just blow away the differencing VHD. If we want another virtual machine to use that same OS, we just create a differencing VHD for it on top of the same base. So we have one image for all the machines. And the same thing happens with your role code. You get a differencing VHD, so if you want to reset, you can reset back to your original role VHD state. And then there's a third one, the resource VHD. This resource VHD is a VHD that serves as your cache. It can be up to, I think it's a terabyte in size if you've got an extra large. This is where you can stick whatever you want to. Remember that it's stateless programming model, so whatever you stick there, be prepared to lose. There's only actually one kind of scenario where you're going to lose that code or that data that you store there, and I'll tell you what that is, but you should treat it as volatile. Then the guest agent starts your host. The host starts the VM, attaches the VHDs, calls your entry point. The guest agent fires up, calls your entry point, and starts talking to you. When you say you're ready, then the load balancer starts letting traffic through to you. Let's go inside my role, to do that, I'm going to actually TS up into the cloud, because you can now RDP into instances. So I'm going to RDP into this instance. We'll take a look at what's inside of one of these machines. This is a worker role from the Branding Police deployment. I've got my favorite tool in there. Actually, if you want, email me and I'll give you the startup task script that will install Process Explorer inside your Windows Azure VMs and make it the default task manager. Watch, I can do task manager, and there we go. The life the way it should be. So when we take a look inside this virtual machine, we've got a few pieces of code highlighted in yellow, just coincidentally. This is managed code. Actually, most of Windows Azure is written in managed code. This is the Windows Azure agent, the guest agent I've been talking about right there. There's this bootstrapper helper process. This is the remote access agent, which is responsible for managing RDP traffic into the VM. And then this is the host for your role entry point. This is where your DLL lives. And when we click that open and look at the DLL view, here's my role DLL right there, worker role.dll. And that's essentially it for what's going on compute-wise. There's a forwarder. So when you RDP into a front end, the RDP traffic can be forwarded to your back end, so you can talk to any of the back ends you want to. If you take a look at the TCP view, you can see that there's a few connections here that are interesting. One is here. Remember that the worker role is talking to, listening on a queue, and we can see that queue connection here. Now, we're not supposed to tell you where our data centers are, so I can't tell you what that might stand for, but it's North Central US. That's the only hint I'll give you. It's highly sensitive information. Then so that's one connection. That's the worker host there talking my DLL talking. And then there's another connection, too, which is the app agent here. And this is actually going to be talking to the host agent through that IP address right there. So that's talking to the IP address that's projected from the host into the guest to do the pinging and everything else. If you take a look at disk management, here's looking at the layout of the disks. There's three disks you can see. What disk zero is Windows, D. This is the differencing VHD on top of the host image. Disk one here is C. That's your resource VHD. This is a dynamic VHD that just gets blown away. If your service gets destroyed, this is a temporary cache. And then there's F here, which is your role. And if we take a look at F, here's the app root directory, and this is where your DLL is stored. And this is where I stuck process monitor. Here's the script that starts up when my role starts to create process monitor. Process Explorer is the default task manager. So that's a look inside a role. VM roles deploy a little bit differently. They go through multiple differencing VHDs because you give us a base and you give us a diff for that base so that you don't have to give us a new base every time you want to update. And then we create another differencing VHD, of course, a secondary one on top of that base. When your node starts up, that differencing VHD gets, or those VHDs get faulted in, kind of demand paged into your node through a caching service that runs in the data center to cache data close to the machines. So you don't have to go to blob store every time. Let's talk about updating now. There's two update types. You've already seen one of them, the in-place update. That's just going mark update domain by update domain. Then there's another update type. This is the VIP swap, or swap VIP update type. This one, you've got two slots to deploy your service into, one's staging and one's production. You've got a service over here in production. Now you want to create a new, update your service with brand new code. You bring it up in a staging environment. You can test now against it, make sure it's up and running and healthy. When you're ready, you swap them. And your staging becomes production, your production becomes staging. This happens with the load balancers swinging load balance traffic over from one to the other. And then when you're done when this now new staging service, the old production service, is finished processing whatever traffic it had received before the flip, then you shut it down. Or you don't have to shut it down. It continues to use VM resources if you don't shut it down, which is fine by us because you continue to pay for those compute hours, but you might want to shut them down if you don't want to pay us extra money. Update type characteristics. So what can you change when you update? This grid is for your own reference. Today, in the grays, in-place update have some limitations where you can't change parts of your service and do an in-place update. But by this summer, in the next 2 months, those grays will all be yes. And so you will be able to do anything you want to your service and do it as an in-place update. With VIP swap, you can change everything except for your endpoint topology because that's required to do this swapping of VIPs, the load balancer traffic. And the in-place update detail, the only thing I'll mention here is that we shut down your service, then we take that VHD, the new role instance VHD, we attach it to the VM, and then we detach the old one. That means that your drive letters change. So I was showing you drive letter E there for your role. That will change to drive letter F if I updated the service, and then flip back to E the next time. And the host OS upgrade, so guess how often we have to patch the data center? Once a month, right? Good guess. So this patch, shortly after Patch Tuesday, we go and update all of our data centers, every single of the tens of thousands of machines, and this affects your service, of course. So our goal is to update as quickly as possible for security reasons and just for efficiency, but not violate that SLA we've got with you. So we can't take down more than one of your update domains at a time during the update, and so we have this placement algorithm that really makes it easy. It's a very simple placement algorithm. We try to put update domains, the same update domains on the same nodes, whether it's from your service or another service. So all update domains ones, we can put those on the same blade. When we have the same update domain on the same blade, we can know that we can take down all the blades that have that update domain and only that update domain on them at the same time. If we mix update domains on the same blade, we start to get screwy. First of all, we can't mix your update domains, but we could put update domain from your service and update domain 2 from another service like you see in that bottom picture. And that means that now we can't update multiple blades potentially at the same time because we can't take down two update domains at the same time. This has two effects. One, it lets us update the data center very quickly. And the second is that your roles across your tiers, oftentimes if they fit, will be on the same blade with one another from the same update domain. So if your front end is a small and your back end's a small, update domain ones will very likely be on the same blade sitting side by side, which means that any traffic that goes between those will never even actually go out into the network. Finally, health model. So the load balancer is part of the health model. Your service needs to know when it can accept traffic and not accept traffic and tell us. And we also have to monitor the health of your application to know when the load balancer should be sending stuff to role instances. So the Fabric Controller programs the load balancers, these massive, monstrous load balancers, to probe the guest agent every 15 seconds. There's a GET going to that guest agent through that IP address that I just showed you. Every 15 seconds, it responds to the guest, to the GET request, simple GET. And if it doesn't respond to two of them, the load balancer stops routing traffic. So this would happen if your machine went belly up. If the host machine went belly up, if the guest agent went belly up, the load balancer detects this and stops routing traffic. You can also, in your own role, tell us to turn off the load balancer. You return to the guest agent, I'm busy. The guest agent then will stop responding to pings from the load balancer. Be prepared to let traffic drain, because traffic is going to drain while that load balancer is shutting off the connection. And another question that I see come up over and over again in the Windows Azure internal discussion list is people notice that the load balancer keeps a connection, an idle connection, open for 30 seconds and then shuts it down. And people say, is there any way to change that, any way to override it? The answer is no. If you want to keep the connection open longer than that, use keep alive or send some traffic just to have some activity on that connection. The health model is based on these heartbeats and timeouts. And if you think about it, heartbeats and timeouts are two different concepts in Fabric, because the time to detect a problem is the sum of the heartbeat plus the timeout. If we have to miss two heartbeats, then we could have a worst case if we just had timeouts of up to two timeout periods. And so the heartbeats are faster. And we take certain operation actions that you would just kind of guess intuitively. If a roll instance crashes, we restart the roll. If the guest VM crashes, the host stops getting heartbeats from the guest, and it'll restart the VM. If the host agent crashes, the fabric controller will stop getting pings, and it'll restart the node. And if we detect a hardware issue, because we can detect smart failures proactively, we'll do something called service healing. This graph shows you some of the timeouts that are visible to you as an application developer. There's a guest agent heartbeat of 5 seconds into your agent, from the host. If the guest agent doesn't respond within 10 minutes, then the VM is going to get recycled. And the role instance, you get heartbeated every 15 seconds from the guest agent. If you stop responding to those, you show up as unresponsive. Load balancer stops routing traffic. And you see the load balancer heartbeat is 15 seconds corresponds with that as well. Let me show you a demonstration of this fault tolerance in action with the queues, the branding police service. I'm going to mess with the branding police service while it's in the middle of processing one of its files, one of its PowerPoint files. So I've got instance one on the left, on the right, instance zero on the left. And what I'm going to do is go to the branding police website right here, and I'm going to upload a deck. This just proves that I've created a fault-tolerant service. Give it that same deck. And now we're going to see which instance picks up that queue work item. And it's instance one. So I'm going to go to the right side, and I'm going to suspend the worker host that's going to be processing that. In the cloud version, there's a delay before it actually starts processing it. So what's going to happen here is that queue item disappears from the queue, but it's got a lifetime. If it's not deleted within a certain timeout that you specify, that queue item pops back into the queue. The second worker instance is going to see it then and pick it up. And that's how you get the fault tolerance. So let's see what's happening. And you can see worker instance zero picked it up. Saw that one was down and picked it up because I deleted it. So that's the fault tolerance in action. And so the last case is moving a service. This is the only time you'll lose that resource VHD is when blade fails and we start your instances up on another blade. Of course, the resource VHD is gone. That's why it's the cache. That's the only time you'll lose that. So we try to preserve it as much as possible, but we can't do anything about that. So that brings me to the end of the talk. And I've given you a kind of whirlwind tour from the very high level of the portal, building a little app, deploying it, seeing how it's fault tolerant, showing you a little bit about what's going on underneath the hood with the fabric controller, these concepts of update domains and fault domains to get availability and scalability. I hope that what this has done is give you some more confidence in what Windows Azure is about. I know that me of all people, I need to know what's going on underneath the hood to feel like I know that the people that are developing this thing are sane. And so hopefully I've given you an idea that we know what we're doing here underneath the hood of Windows Azure and makes you more confident about going and trying out Windows Azure and deploying your applications to it. Again, the Fabric Controller is responsible for all of these data center operations managing the service, and there's a bunch of innovation that's going to be coming. I mean, we're hard at work on a number of things, bringing identity services into the Fabric Controller. Today, services have no implicit identity. That's one of the things I'm working on, so that you don't have to use data connection strings for your service to talk to storage. You can just set an ACL and say, this service has this access. That just happens transparently. The portal, role-based access control in the portal will be part of the identity system. That's another thing. Management protocol is another thing, for example, that we're doing so that you can coordinate with us on updates. And support for stateful services is part of that. So if you think about it, all I've been discussing are stateless services, but there are such a thing as stateful services running on Windows Azure today. SQL Azure and Windows Azure Storage are stateful services. They are actually storing data on their blades that they need to protect. And these are examples of stateful services that have special requirements that we built into the fabric. We'll be exposing it to you guys so you can build stateful services as well on top of the Fabric controller. So in any case, I hope this was a good introduction and a good overview. And I've got a couple more things. I've got book signing for Zero Day at 12:30 in the Tech Ed bookstore. And I'm doing one last session today, Case the Unexplained. It's a really fun one at 2:45. So I hope to see you there at one of those two events. And if I don't see you, have a great trip back. And I hope you had a great Tech Ed.